also up there. Shall we adopt the provisions of RSA 40:13, known as SB 2, to allow official ballot voting on all issues before the town of Rollinsford on the second Tuesday of March? So at this point, you know, the ground rules are, please wait to be recognized. We'll let everyone have at least an opportunity to speak. And I would first like to start with someone who would like to speak to this petition or article. Please say your name and address, of course.
Everybody can hear me okay?
Yeah, he's a bit low.
Okay, I have testimony I wish to enter into the record, and this is what it is. The history of participation in town governments has evolved over the years. In colonial times, the only people allowed to vote were the white male landowners. Renters like tenant farmers and sharecroppers, as well as those without the property rights, hired hands on the farms, could not participate. And those having power thought this was just fine and appropriate in an appropriate way to run government. Then after the Civil War, with the passage of the 14th Amendment, the right to vote was expanded to all males living in the town or state. And I'm sure those who previously held power thought a fine tradition had been ruined by expanding enfranchisement to those who had previously been denied a voting right. Over time, however, those who held power, meaning the white male landowners of the town or state, accepted the wider granting of participation in government. Until 1920, when the 19th Amendment was passed, allowing women the right to vote, that's what changed. A quick search on the internet reveals how men felt about their right to be the controllers of government. The role of women up to that point was to be in the back of the hall, serving coffee and pie. Now another fine tradition fell in the face of even wider enfranchisement. And somehow the earth continued to turn, the sun rose in the east, and civilization as we knew it managed to adapt. In 1995, the legislature of the state of New Hampshire realized that the fine old tradition of town meetings was becoming more and more restrictive to a core group of power holders, and they passed SB 2. SB 2 meant that those citizens who could not attend a sometimes marathon town meeting and tried to decide the spending of the town in a few brief hours of superficial explanations could now reflect on decisions of the town in a more leisurely fashion and vote their support or lack thereof in the privacy of the polling booth. Last year, 66 voters petitioned the town to adopt SB 2. And in the final count, 391 voters said yes, 292 voted no, a ratio of 57%, very close to passage. This year, 197 voters signed. I gotta do this, I'm moving this. This year, 197 voters signed a petition, and one might reasonably guess that more individuals are in favor of SB 2 for the town than last year. As for the argument that, quote, a small but motivated group at the deliberative session could hijack the process and re-engineer the warrant articles that voters are then presented with in the March balloting. There's absolutely no evidence to support that assertion, and the process for the school, which has been SB 2, does not support that assertion either. In fact, as has been traditionally the case, those who held power, like male white landowners of the past, traditional town meetings have become controlled by those who can spare the time to attend the meeting because they aren't elderly, in poor health, have to work for a living, out of town on town meeting day, or otherwise find the atmosphere of the town meeting hostile or unresponsive. SB 2 represents a means, if somewhat imperfect, to allow more citizens to participate in the decisions of the town, and thereby widening the ability of the people to be part of the decision-making process. SB 2 represents another step in making the democracy of town governance a more inclusive and truly representative process like those changes in the past. Thank you.
Thank you, Glenn. Is there anyone else who would like to speak to this petition?
I am just curious. This year was amongst the first years I've seen the select board put out a voter's guide. If this gets passed by the voters, will the select board, this select board, continue to do that in the future? And would that put more of a burden on you to put a voter's guide out? Or should we be looking at the community members to come up with a voter's guide?
So I don't know the answer to that question. The board would still try to do the voter's guide, would still like to do projections. But in order to respond directly to something that Mr. Crozier said, I put this little graphic up there. So that was my quote, by the way, that he quoted, so I feel I can respond to that. So what I'm talking about is not so much ballot day, when we've had as many 700 or 800 people come out to vote. It's what happens at the deliberative session, which happens in January, cold month, a snowy month, when, as Fernie said, it's not easy for many people to come out and participate. And this is what has happened in other parts of the state, which is why legislators from both sides of the aisle have looked for ways to try to change SB 2, because it is quite less than perfect. So we take this year as an example. Our FY16 approved budget was that $1.6 million that you see there. The $1.754 is this year's select board proposed budget. And the reason it has such an increase is because we had enough increase in revenue to help support it. And it's the one that has the support of the elected select board. So one could imagine a deliberative session in the middle of winter where the weather's not very fine, and there is nothing on the warrant that seems particularly difficult for people, so they choose not to come. But a very small and motivated group of people do show up and decide to reduce the select board budget to $1,700,000. These are not elected people. They're people who are acting as the legislative body of the deliberative session, but they've just reduced our budget. So now what goes to the voters is a yes or no on this particular bottom line. And so I don't know what the select board would choose to do with regard to this. I mean, if we recommended that $1.7 million, it would be about $55,000 less than the select board's proposed budget. If we voted no, then we use the default budget, which is that of the years before, and it would be $134,000 less. So either way, it puts a board in a really difficult position to try to govern. And the same is true for every warrant that's on that article. It has to do with, I think, with money. I don't know that they can change others, I'm not sure. I mean, you could reduce something by an amount that makes it impossible to fulfill. And you just look at the warrant articles that we have this year. And if it just a small number of people who are so motivated to do so arrive at the deliberative session, that is in fact what can happen. And that is what would show up on the ballot for the voters to vote on. Is there anyone else who would like to speak?
Thank you.
there anyone else who would like to speak? Anyone else who would like to speak? Going once?
Tom Coons, Stockdale Circle. I'm not hearing anything that's really jumping out, compelling me to support this. I understand that there's concern about attendance at meetings, people having trouble getting out, but this is something that's gone on for decades, hundreds of years. And I would imagine it's a lot harder to get to a meeting 200 years ago than it is now. But the whole idea of being able to discuss, the topics that are being, the different warrant articles, the different objects and things in our budgets, to be able to really discuss them. And yes, to your point, Suzanne, potentially change for the good or the bad. It really is indicative of who shows up. But my point is this. This is an opportunity. People know these meetings are happening. They happen at the same time every year. And yes, some people cannot make the meetings. Some people are in town. Some people are in Rollinsford half the year. Now, unfortunately, they choose the wrong time of year to be out of Rollinsford. They won't be able to come to this meeting. And I can't do anything about that. But for me, I live in this town 365 days a year. I come to these meetings. I have a family, I have a small child, and other kids that are running around the house, and I have obligations elsewhere, but I make time. I do. And I think it's important. To be able to debate and potentially change things, that's something that I, that's a right I have, to be able to discuss things in front of the town. But I'm not hearing anything that's telling me there's something really broken with the system and we need to change it. And to Brian's point, yeah, the voting may have been close last year. But I would guarantee you, if you ask any one of those voters if they could intelligently describe for you the difference between the two, most would. Most of the people I've asked about it really can't tell me the difference. Even some of the folks that were at the transfer station asking for signatures really couldn't tell me the difference. What is the difference? How is it going to benefit this town? I'm not seeing it. I'm just not seeing it. There's nothing on this that's saying this is absolutely going to work for us. And the other thing I would say is to anybody who is concerned, I would ask them if the current system we have has failed this town. And I would say that it hasn't, but not with the number of people that show up. Yeah, even when the weather's bad, the number of people that show up to discuss, to debate, to argue points. They're very heated, but you can tell that people, they mean business when they're coming here. And I think that that's something we really need, as a town, we really need to consider. Because from what I've read, some of the towns that have already gone to this are finding it difficult to change back. And I think that that's something to consider as well. So, thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak? Yes, I see someone. Yeah. Elaine, thank you.
Lorraine Benson Watson Lane. I spoke last year, I remember this came up on the ballot, and when it came up last year, one of the things that was disturbing to many of us was the problem that we had just financially dealing with this. One of the issues is that when the deliberative session is held, we don't have the final figures for the spending of the prior year. We don't have even a preliminary audit of the figures that we would have, that the voters are able to utilize and look to when they do the March meeting. So basically, the information that is given at the deliberative session is, in fact, somewhat incomplete. That's not very helpful, I don't think. If we were to try to make sure it was very complete, we'd have people working overtime through the holiday season. That doesn't really work either for us, because that would be costly. I don't see the point of doing that either. So from just that point of view, it's not very helpful to do a different type of thing than what we're presently doing. The other issue I'm looking at is everybody saying, well, you know, if you don't like the warrant articles, you can change them at a deliberative session rather than at the town meeting. Well, I think it would be just as easy to go to the town meeting, discuss them, and vote on them right then and there. They say, well, you can vote absentee. Sure, you can, but you won't know anything more about the warrant articles than what, in fact, was said at the deliberative session. And if you didn't go, you don't know. So you're somewhat uninformed. Thanks.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak to the honorable?
Good evening. My name is Charlie Putnam. I live on 85 Slido Road. I'm not going to speak for or against SB2. I'm currently the moderator for the school district. I recently elected to be the town moderator for the town meeting. And I feel comfortable moderating in both sessions. I think that I wanted to respond to a couple of things that were said here tonight. My view is that voters of the town of Rollins are the ones who get to decide and vote on what the budget, what the warrant articles are going to contain, and ultimately on whether or not those warrant articles pass. It seems to me that the burden on voters is the same burden whether or not we are in a town meeting form of government or an SB2 form of government. The burden is to become well informed. The burden is to have input. The burden is to become well educated and well informed about the issues that are going to be decided. And the burden is to make good decisions about what's going to affect all of us, friends and neighbors, people we agree with, people that look like us, people that don't look like us. I'm a little surprised that one of the arguments that is being asserted in support of SB2 is that those of us who are involved in town meeting are some form of an elite. And that we're doing something different to the rest of the town than we are doing to ourselves. And that strikes me as a fundamentally flawed argument, a fundamentally unfair argument to the people in town who are friends and neighbors who participate in good faith in these processes. And it seems to me that it covers up an important part of the process, which is that if we move to SB2, it's going to be just as important for people to come out, get informed, learn what the issues are, make careful decisions about what is ultimately going to be contained in the warrant article, and the, for lack of a better word, what I think is the scam here is to tell people that, you just need to show up on voting day and you'll absolutely understand all there is that needs to be known about these warrant articles. No, the burden is going to continue to be the same on voters. What I see is the potential benefit of SB2, and I've listened to these arguments now for nearly 30 years, is that more people will get to exercise their right to vote on what the final warrant article is. And that's an important, argument. It's an argument that's worth consideration. But in the process, let's make that argument and not slander the people who take the time to come out and become informed. My commitment as town moderator is to run a meeting where people who want to be heard will be heard fairly, where personal attacks will not be allowed, and where people feel that they get a fair hearing. My personal pledge to the voters in this town is that if I don't do that job, find somebody else who can do it, because it's very important that you have somebody that can facilitate the deliberative process, whether it's an SB2 or a town meeting.
Thank you, Charlie. Does anyone else would like to speak to the petition? Can I check? Anyone who hasn't spoken yet who would like to speak to the petition article? Okay, Celia.
Celia Maple, I just had a thought of how does the SB2 change the time frame for the deliberative session versus town meeting? I know for the school we meet in February, the end of January is in February, so we'll be ready for voting day. Does the SB2 change that so that the deliberative session is well before the voting day?
Yes, I don't know the precise windows, but we would need to have a public hearing. That doesn't change, hosted by the budget committee, and then the deliberative session. And it would likely have to be in January or early February. Again, I don't know what the window is. And so, as I think Lorraine Hansen pointed out, we have to get more material together ahead of time. Rather than come out for a Saturday morning town meeting in March, we would encourage all of those same voters to be just as engaged and to come out to that deliberative session. It will be in January, in wintertime as opposed to March. I mean, that's one of the differences with regard to how and when you become engaged in this process. Okay. Is there anyone else who would like to speak to this?
So that the school budget doesn't really change after that. Everybody has sufficient time, I would say, to prepare the budget that's going to be proposed for deliberative. My other point is there was a question about how this process is broken. I see it as being broken when you get somewhere between 2 and 10% of your registered voters showing up to vote uninformed. It's equally broken when you get 40% of your registered voters showing up to vote. So I can't help but stress the onus is really on people to stay informed, but on the town to keep them informed as well. And personally, I would rather have 700 informed voters making a decision for this town than 100 or 50.
Is there anyone who'd like to speak? Thank you, Kim. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak? All right, is there somebody who hasn't spoken yet? And we're going to limit this to 2. Is that okay with everybody? All right, thank you.
Tom from Scottsdale Circle. I agree that we should have informed voters. Unfortunately, you know, people are busy. They're not able to always make meetings. And that's a problem, but yeah, unfortunately, that's life. I'd love to see this place packed with 700 people attending. That would be great. There would be lots of conversations we would get out of here at about 5 o'clock. But the truth is that, you know, voters need to educate themselves. You know, it can't be spoon-fed. The town, you guys do a great job providing us with the information. I've gone to these meetings and, you know, very well. The people leave here knowing exactly what's going on. And I think that it really is incumbent upon the voters. You know, if you're going to go into the voting booth, you should probably know what you're voting on. And I can't blame the town for that. You know, we have meetings. We have lots of meetings. We have select board meetings. We have school board meetings. We have people that are, as a member of the school board, I can tell you our attendance is not high. So, you know, we're not packing this room with folks. Yet, when it comes to our, you know, to voting on our budget, I mean, we get incredible questions. And people are concerned because they didn't know. But we've had meetings every month for the previous 12 months leading up to that, and all of these things we discussed. So I think, I say it's the responsibility of the voter to inform themselves. This information has been. And if they have questions, you guys are all available to reach out to. And I would just say it's really their responsibility.
Carrie Boyle, 150 Clement Road. There's a lot of talk about uninformed voters. I think we should probably give the residents of Rollinsford some credit, because everyone's focusing on that. So I think we should give them a little bit more credit. It's up to the voter to educate themselves. But I also know, too, there is not a test that you have to take before you come to vote. So again, I just think we should give the residents a little bit more credit and not assume or make so much about the informed voters.
Thank you, Carrie.
Is there anyone else who would like to speak to this petition or article? We'll just add, it will be the board's role should this pass to get as many voters or resident voters to our deliberative session as now do come to town meeting, because the focus shifts, right? And that's why I get concerned about the number of people who may show up at a deliberative session, because that becomes equally important to the vote that happens in March, and maybe even more so, because it determines what those 700 people vote on. You could be as informed as you would like to be in March, but if something happened at that deliberative session that you might not have liked, I mean, that's where you need to turn out to have your voice heard in the finalization of the warrants that are shown to the voters at the March meeting. Is there anyone who would like to speak to this petition warrant article? Going once, going twice, going three times. Thank you so much. It's an important process. I appreciate your coming out tonight. The board is going to stay and hold its regular board meeting here. I think first, though, I'd like to get the room sort of put back so that we're not having to do this at 10 o'clock tonight. So it would give us the patience to at least clean out before we start the board meeting. I appreciate it.